But what about this little detail at verse 40, when the sun was setting? I think a lot of commentators overlook that detail, and yet it is a significant point. You see, when did the Jew consider the new day to begin? It was at sundown, wasn't it? And by the way, they get that from the book of Genesis. At the creation account, it says the evening and the morning were the first day. The evening and the morning were the second day. So the Jews are saying, well, a day begins at the evening. When's the evening begin? Sundown. So Jesus was in the synagogue and having dinner there at Peter's house and all on the Sabbath. So basically, the Sabbath is over when the sun sets. And that's when this big crowd shows up. Now, if you know the Bible and the Gospels there in a little detail, you may already see where I'm going on this. You remember, Jesus got in trouble with the religious leaders, the scribes and Pharisees. They actually criticized Jesus for healing on the Sabbath. You remember that? They thought, this man can't be from God because he's healing on the Sabbath. Where did they get that idea? It all goes back to taking the Word of God, which was very simple, very straightforward. Hey, on the Sabbath day, you set it apart. You keep it holy. It's a day of rest. You don't work on the Sabbath like you do the other 6 days of the week. You don't work, your animals don't work, your servants don't work, no one works. Instead, you worship God and you rest on the seventh day, the Sabbath. But over the years, the scribes and the Pharisees, and they began to debate, well, what does it mean to work? What does it mean to carry a burden? We're not supposed to carry a burden on the Sabbath. Well, how do you define a burden? How much change in my pocket can I have? Am I carrying a burden? And they began to think about all these examples and began to write them down. And this had this pages after pages after pages of what it took to properly keep the Sabbath. So now you're just an average Jew wanting to keep God's law, and you're scared to death you might accidentally break one of the rules of the Sabbath. And so your day of rest has become a big day of burden, hasn't it? And that's what Jesus addressed when he said, look, man wasn't made for the Sabbath. The Sabbath was made for man. It was given to man, not the other way around. So one of their teachings had to do with, gosh, what happens if someone gets really hurt on the Sabbath? What do we do? Because we're not allowed to work. And so it was concluded, well, if he's hurt so bad that he might die, you can go ahead and seek to save his life. But you can't do anything that might lead to his healing. So, here I am, I got a horrible wound, and I'm just bleeding, and I might bleed out and die. It was okay to do a tourniquet and just, you know, keep my blood flow stopped. But you're going to have to wait till sundown before we do any further first aid and, you know, try to take care of you. So you can do what it takes to save someone's life, but then that was it. You couldn't heal. Now, again, none of that's in the Bible. The Bible is pretty simple and pretty clear. Just keep the Sabbath. It's a day of rest. But what we see, I think, from this little detail here and the example of the crowd is the effect that this tradition of man had on the people. You see? Oh, I hear that there's this guy who can heal diseases. I can't wait till the Sabbath is over so he'll be willing to heal mine. Because certainly if he's a man of God, he doesn't want to heal me on the Sabbath. So I'll wait till the sun sets in my agony for a few more hours before I go see him. How tragic, isn't it? And I was just thinking of how we could have a modern example today. How many in the church are being held back because of what they have been influenced by, which is really nothing but human tradition, but they're convinced this is God's will, this is what his word says. But it's really tradition. You can't do that, you can't do that. And God might have a wonderful plan, and they never experience it because of man's tradition. How many times I've heard people tell me that when they were growing up, it was drilled into them, only the priest, only the pastor can ever talk about the Bible. Who are you to bring up the Bible to me at the dinner table? You know, and I was reading the Bible, I was confused about, we don't talk about the Bible here, you're not a priest. Is that what God's word says, though? Far from it. The Bible's given for all of us, isn't it? It's God's word. Even when it was written in the New Testament, it was written in the common Greek language. It wasn't some high intellectual Greek that only the academics would know. It was the common language of the day. And the early church recognized the importance of translating it into the common language of other people who maybe didn't know Greek. So it began from the very beginning in languages that were very influential in the 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 4th centuries. As the gospel spread, the Bible began to be translated into those languages. And to this present day, it's still being translated into the common languages of people around the world who don't yet have the scripture in their own tongue. It's God's intention that we all have the Word of God, that we all read from it, that we all study it, that we all learn from it. And there are other examples we could give as well, where because of the tradition someone grows up under, you know, all those devil instruments that the rock and roll guys, you know, use. You know, you can't as a Christian ever play one of those things. Well, I'm going to play for the glory of God. No, you can't pick it up. It's a sin to even pick one of those things up and learn it and take a lesson or whatever. Where do you get that from the scripture? It's tradition. And so, the tradition we see influencing the people here as they said, well, we can't go till the sun sets because he won't see us till then. Oh, he would have seen them earlier. Of course he would have.